right. I think we can start. I think all of you knows about the great experimental effort that is put into looking for primordial gravitational waves. And I don't think anybody will complain if I say that this effort is led at the moment by the BICEP collaboration. So we are going to learn more about the theory behind primordial gravitational waves next week. And we are happy to have Chao-Lin Kuo from Stanford, who is one of the principal investigators of this collaboration. And his title is Search for Inflationary Gravitational Waves with B-Mode Polarization, the BICEP Program and Beyond. Thank you.
Thank you, Paolo. So the key point here is not only the gravitational waves, as you know, have been discovered by LIGO recently, but we knew that it existed even before that. So the key here is we're trying to look for the primordial gravitational wave that came from the beginning. So it's kind of interesting that if you look at the edge of space, which is black hole, you use gravitational wave. If you look for edge of time, you look for gravitational wave as well, which is the thing that I'm talking about. So it's just a coincidence, maybe not. Okay, so as you learn from the summer school, that cosmic microwave background is this interface between opaque and ionized and hot, dense epoch of the universe to the transparent, neutral universe. And that interface looks like a firewall in all direction that's opaque to photons. So it has a typical 2.7 Kelvin blackbody radiation, and there's tiny temperature fluctuation on it in different directions. And it's great. You can learn lots of information from it, but it's also a firewall that you can't penetrate. You can't look beyond that wall just using photons because it's opaque beyond that point, or the universe was opaque earlier than that epoch. So you don't see any of that, okay? Except you need a messenger that interacts very weakly with all that hot, dense medium, which is gravitational waves, which, of course, interacts very weakly because gravity is so weak compared to other forces. So in principle, by using gravitational waves, you can study the beginning of everything. And that beginning, lots of theories have this interesting feature of rapid expansion, which you will hear about next week, known as the inflationary period. So we don't directly try to detect the gravitational waves like the LIGO guys do. Instead, we look for electromagnetic radiation from the surface of last gathering, the cosmic microwave background radiation. So we look for an imprint of gravitational wave on that cosmic microwave background, polarization. Okay, so we look for microwave linear polarization. We construct a pattern, and that pattern could be an imprint of primordial gravitational waves. Okay, so this is a microwave experiment looking for a gravitational wave in particular. Linear polarization, okay? The pattern, it's not circular polarization or anything. It's linear polarization creating a pattern of a curl on the sky. So you're going to hear more about this, but inflation is a process that inflates space, but also the quantum fluctuation in space itself for any fields that you have around that time. So for the inflaton field itself that was responsible for inflation, that fluctuation was inflated into density perturbation that you now see in microwave background or galaxy structures. So that part is verified to extremely high precision, and it looks just like inflation, very similar to inflation. So the quanta of gravity, it's not all zero and empty everywhere because everything has to be quantum mechanical, is inflated by inflation to create a background of stochastic gravitational waves. That's what we're trying to study here. So the two processes are very similar. In fact, they're described by very similar equations that describe the amplitude of this perturbation or amplitude of tensor perturbation, very similar. And that solution looks, for a particular Fourier mode, that solution looks like this. It has a decaying Fourier wave thing, and then the amplitude is frozen at horizon exit when that the wavelength of that mode is comparable to the Hubble length at that time. Okay, so beyond that point, the wave becomes frozen, the amplitude becomes frozen until that until the universe expands, until inflation ends, and the universe expands to include that wavelength, naturally to include that wavelength. So next week, you're going to hear more about this. But for a given Fourier mode, for a fixed fixed wavelength, co-moving wavelength, so that mode exits the horizon during inflation, the amplitude is frozen until it re-enters into the horizon. So it was leaves first and enters, leaves late and enters early. So that picture here, and as the universe expands. So this is different wavelength, different Fourier modes, okay? So as you recall, cosmic microwave background is a snapshot at a time, okay? So you're just seeing all these Fourier modes. So some of these Fourier modes are beyond the horizon. Some of these Fourier modes are already inside of the horizon. So if you flip this picture this way, not yet, you see something like this, okay? And this is that interface. This is the horizon scale. Beyond that, it's everything, all the modes are outside of the horizon, and this is all inside of the horizon, already processed by ordinary classical physics. This is an actual measurement made by Planck, an experiment of ESA. This is a temperature power spectrum plotted against theory. So this must be one of the most successful physics experiment out there that verifies a theory. Okay, so this is an actual measurement, and the spectrum looks like this, just like the theory predicted. So we're getting serious about this picture, this whole mechanism, generation of perturbation and the processes that involves the perturbation. And the tensor part, or the gravitational wave part, is a natural byproduct of all of this, okay? So this is all real. So now, we just don't know what the amplitude is of that tensor component or the gravitational wave component. So I use the two words interchangeably, primordial gravitational waves or tensor, okay? So the amplitude of the gravitational wave tells you the energy scale of inflation because it tells you the exit of horizon, that scale that I was telling you about. I'm not going to derive all of this next week. Somebody else will. So inflation field range during inflation, the field range during inflation, whether it's greater or smaller than the Planck scale, depends on whether R is greater or smaller than roughly 0.01 plus or minus an order of magnitude or half an order of magnitude, okay? So if you measure R to be 0.05, the inflaton field moves more than a Planck scale during inflation. This is just from the integral of the inflation equation, assuming a single field slow roll. So you need to have quantum gravity in order to have any perturbation. So gravity has to be quantized. So if you see classical gravitational waves stochastic on the sky, just like when you say these perturbation came from quantum mechanics, this has to come from quantum gravity. And if you see a scale invariant tensor, you're just measuring the Hubble scale during inflation. So it'll be very hard to not say that the Hubble scale or the scales that drive the expansion of the universe, the energy density, remains constant during inflation. So that's almost the definition of inflation, if you will. Okay, so that's why, you know, the search for this B mode is a big deal, because of all these theoretical reasons. Not because we want to discover gravitational wave yet over again. Okay. So we don't try to directly measure the metric, space-time metric. Instead, we search for a pattern in cosmic microwave background polarization. So it was due to these guys who proposed that you just look for a curl component in the linear polarization in the microwave background. So this mode looks like a radial pattern or circular pattern. It's called E mode or gradient mode. And this curly pattern is known as the curl mode or the B mode, analogous to electromagnetism. So polarization pattern, as you know, this blue sky is polarized by radio scattering. So radio scattering is nothing but just, you know, E&M wave moving the, you know, charge in the molecule, air molecule around. So it's very similar to Thomson scattering, which is just free electron version of that, same thing. So if you take a polarizer and map that blue sky, what would you get? So the only source, active source, is the sun, which is unpolarized, largely. So the sky is polarized, as you know, whoever had sunglasses. But if you just go one step beyond that, you map the polarization of the whole sky, right? What would you see? You're going to see this. You're going to see a circular pattern around the sun, because there's no other way. You can't create this curl pattern. There's nothing that breaks that left-right symmetry, right? Okay, so that unpolarized light gets scattered by the molecules there. Has to be polarized perpendicular to that direction. There's no way you can get this. Okay? So this is, in fact, a B-mode polarization that you won't see caused by radio scattering. So this is a nice high school, you know, science project. If you have cousins to supervise, tell them to do this. Like looking for B-modes in the blue sky. So just for this summer school, we created a little app that demonstrates that. Okay, so you have a source, and you just, you know, there's a ring of free electrons during the scattering, and you can linearly superpose these, and you get different. You can even move the circle. That's too much. I mean, don't, like, my undergrad just got too excited about Java programming. But anyway, you see what I'm saying? So no matter what you do, you can't create a curl, okay? You just keep adding sources, you just add it in third dimension, you can't create a curl unless you have gravitational waves or lensing or dust. Somebody's gonna ask me a question about that later. But that's my theoretical introduction of why we're doing this, and why is this related to gravitational waves, and why is this related to inflation. So now, how are you doing this? Look, this is an experiment that proves Big Bang or proves the origin of us, or so on. Everybody should be doing it. Why is it so hard? Like, why is it so competitive? Because even though that nice pattern is unique, the degree of polarization defined by the linear polarization power difference is one part in 30 million, okay? So it's usually called an unpolarized light, not polarization, okay? So if you measure this light, it's highly polarized compared to this, I guarantee you. So this is not just a matter of getting the sensitivity to see sub-microkelvin, you know, temperature differences, but also make sure you're not measuring the polarization of the instrument itself, okay, to better than one part in 30 million. Okay? Usually that's impossible, but fortunately, you know, we learn a few tricks, and each trick can get you down factor of 20, 30, and you multiply these together, all of a sudden, you're getting there. Okay? So it's a little hard to just write down in a textbook, you know, how you're going to do this from first principles. So, you know, that's why it's also very fun to be an experimentalist, you know. And if you're sharp in physics, if you have sharp physics intuition, you can add another technique to bring this down by another order of magnitude, okay? That sometimes is kind of opaque in textbooks. So I've been doing this in this place for the past 15 years. This is South Pole. And how far away of this from the South Pole itself? It's directly at the South Pole. We walk by the pole of the South Pole every day to get lunch out in the cold. So this is a great place to do cosmic microwave background because it's actually a desert. So South Pole is the driest place on Earth. Not the Sahara, not the Mojave Desert, here. Because even if you have 100% humidity, there's no water because the cold temperature just can't sustain any water vapor in the atmosphere. Also, it only had one day and one night. That's how we trick our winter over to observe for us. We say, you observe for one night. Only one night. Okay? But then, you know, he's stuck there for 6 months. So there's great logistical support from United States NSF Office of Polar Program. So the flights are military flights. I had to brief to the commander once to tell her, it was a woman, what we were doing. It was the commander of the entire U.S. Air Force. I had to brief to her what we were doing at the South Pole, using her fleet once. So this is the collaboration in a collaboration meeting that we had about a year ago, okay? It's getting bigger as we're building more and more receivers and we're running into foregrounds and other issues in analysis, okay? So we're including more and more people in this collaboration, but it's not LHC, you know, size yet, hopefully. So this is kind of the evolution of the project since we even skip BICEP 1. Okay, so since BICEP 1 was 2005, we started doing this at the same place using a similar technique. Okay, from BICEP 1 to BICEP 2, we implemented a from just traditional horn-coupled detectors like the Planck satellite has, to photolithographic superconductive detectors. And then we copied that receiver five times over to form an array. We call it Keck array. It's still observing now. BICEP 2 is done, by the way. BICEP 2 has been replaced by BICEP 3 in the year 2005. They're all very similar, but in fact, they're very different because BICEP 3 is like several times bigger than BICEP 2, so they look the same on the picture or in a drawing, but when you're building it, you know how that's the challenge. That's the big step that you have to go. So BICEP 3 has been observing since 2015. Just this past few months, we fully populated the focal plane, and then we're moving to an array of BICEP 3-like telescopes, starting hopefully in 2 years. We call BICEP array. There's an extra three in there. So these are all refracted telescopes, used similar to the ones used by Kepler a long time ago, not far from here, or Galileo. So these are microwave telescopes using ceramic or plastic lenses, two lenses, and the detectors are operating at 0.25 Kelvin, low temperature detectors. It's similar to a typical tabletop. The size is also similar to a tabletop condensed matter experiment, except we have to open up the window, otherwise you don't see anything. And 100 watts of radiation is just going in, and you have to reject all of that before you can cool the detectors down. So very different sets of challenges just from there. Okay? So the detectors are polarization sensitive. Like I said earlier, we're measuring linear polarization, which is defined to be the E squared, the power difference between this polarization versus that. That's Q, or rotate the whole thing by 45 degrees. That's U polarization. Okay, so we have two sets of antennas, one for each polarization, and we have two detectors that monitors the power entering those antenna, and you take the difference as the telescope scans. Okay, so you're constantly taking the difference between two polarization as the telescope scans, and you spin the telescope around, you move it up and down to form a map. So the actual detection of power is done through a superconductive thermometer. It's a superconductive film bias at the transition from normal to superconductivity. So that makes it a very sensitive thermometer. So that monitors the temperature of the CMB light coming from the antenna getting dumped into this resistor heating up the island. Okay, so you're just measuring the temperature of that island to give you an idea what's the power coming through from the antenna. One for each polarization, and you take the difference of the two. Okay, some glamour shots of these detectors. And then you just go through map making to make a polarization map where, you know, at each pixel you have a length and a direction. That's the definition of linear polarization. And all of a sudden, so this is BICEP 2, by the way, all of a sudden, and this is actual data, all of a sudden, you see this is mostly E-mode already. So remember that, either circular or radial pattern. And indeed, if you just go through linear algebra and project out the E-modes, this is all you get. So what we measure is mostly E-mode. Already, that's a huge success for that nice picture of CMB photons scattering light has to generate E-mode. But, you know, we're doing something harder. We want to blow up the scale and see whether there's B-mode left. And that's what we did, okay? And now the scale is at 0.3 microkelvin. On top of 3 Kelvin microkelvin, 3 Kelvin, this is microkelvin, 3 Kelvin microwave background, and on top of 10 Kelvin emission from the atmosphere, and another 10 from the instrument. Okay, so you're trying to measure the temperature difference of 0.3 microkelvin over 30 Kelvin of loading. Okay, very little difference. So that's why you need very sensitive detectors. And that integration, you know, took 3 years, right? Okay, so you have to just integrate out the noise to get the map. So BICEP 2 saw a lot of B-mode polarization, you've heard about that. So, and we threw in Keck data taken through the end of 2014. And you just turn that into a power spectrum. Power spectrum is a amplitude as a function of wavelength. Okay, you're gonna hear more about, or maybe you have heard about it already. So this is multiple moment or just wave number. This is about 1 degree. And this line is the prediction from gravitational lensing, which comes from second order of scalar perturbation, basically. Scalar perturbation lens by large-scale structure can generate a B-mode polarization. And you, nowadays, you know exactly what that level would be. And this is what BICEP and Keck measured at 150 gigahertz. So it's way beyond what the lensing predicted. So people got excited, we got excited. Okay, so now whether this was actually a gravitational wave, which had a spectrum that, you know, had a peak at around L of 100, by the way, you have to look at other frequencies. So in year 2014, after the initial announcement of a detection of this thing, we started working with the Planck collaboration. So Planck is a satellite mission that produced that beautiful temperature polarization map, okay? So it has also polarization measurements across a wide frequency band. So the instantaneous sensitivity at each direction, each small patch, each pixel is not very great. But the nice thing is it has very wide sky coverage, all whole sky, actually. And it has coverage all the way out to 850 gigahertz. We're in particular interested in the 353 gigahertz polarization measurement because that has the largest sensitivity to galactic dust, which is also polarized. So we started working with them. Also, in the meantime, around 2014, right after we saw something in the signal, in the maps, you know, around early 2013, actually, we decided to put in two receivers at lower frequency, okay? So combining all of that, combining Planck and this low-frequency observations, which is less sensitive to dust. In fact, you can already see that. This is the galaxy, okay? And at high frequency, you see nothing but dust from the galaxy, even at high galactic latitude. And at lower frequencies, like 100, you see less dust polarization. And at lower, even yet lower frequency, you start to see a lot of synchrotron radiation. We don't look in that direction, obviously. Our field is around here. Out here. Okay, combining all of that, this is still 150 only. So this is 95 only, okay? So 95 has less sensitivity to dust. And if this signal is coming from primordial, it'll have the same amplitude, or it'll scatter around, the red point will scatter around that higher point, green point. We can also form cross-correlation between 95 and 150 gigahertz, and this is the result, okay? And if you just go through statistical analysis, you can no longer say there's an excess from, for example, the 95 gigahertz and 150 above the gravitational lensing. If all of this came from primordial, then all of these points will scatter around the same region, but instead they all came down. So, going through the statistical analysis, one has to conclude that we've detected a lot of dust. Okay, this is the amplitude of dust. Zero is ruled out to high significance. That means we see dust at high significance now. There is a lot of dust, but we can't say there is a tensor anymore. So zero is not ruled out at all after you throw in Planck 353 and Keck 95 gigahertz data. But we started to do interesting inflationary science already. So at R of 0.12, 0.13, there's the famous phi squared model, which just means the inflaton potential is a parabola. So that, up till this point, can explain everything in the universe. So that simple model. So inflaton field has a parabolic potential. It produces everything we see today. Okay, so that's a nice model. But now that nice model is being disfavored, okay, by this result, and only by this result. And in the power spectrum space, this is what we got. So this is that lensing that one always gets. And this is the inflationary or tensor spectrum that we're looking for. Okay, so, and this is the latest result when you throw in everything. So, of course, you know, lensing has been detected by other experiments as well, but looks like we've also detected a lot of lensing at this intermediate angular scale. But we're most interested in this low L point, which are now upper limits only. Okay? I should say, if you look at the what are these colors? Brown, orangish points, right? These are the most sensitive measurements on primordial B mode. Okay, they're not exactly primordial. They're crossed between 95 and 150. So it has some dust contribution at 95 as well. But it, you know, to first approximation, these are the primordial measurements, and the size of the error bar is larger than the size of the error bar from BICEP Keck at 150 gigahertz. So look at how tiny the error bars are for the green points. And that's coming from the subtraction of Planck dust template. So we're now limited by our knowledge to dust. But you can get more leverage on dust by going to yet higher frequency. So the next atmospheric window that you can observe is about 220 gigahertz. So we have already collected two seasons worth of 220 gigahertz data. And the map sensitivity is already better than Planck sensitivity to dust at 353. So pretty soon, when we throw in our own 220 gigahertz data, the error bar will start to shrink again. Okay, right now, it doesn't make sense to observe at 150 more because we've already seen high signal to noise of something. So right now, we need to minimize the uncertainty introduced by doing the subtraction or doing the component separation, which currently came from Planck. And we also have rather limited sensitivity, as you can tell, at 95. So the error bar from 95 allo spectrum are much larger than 150. So we want to add a lot more at 95 and improve on dust template, sensitivity to dust template. Okay. So a theorist will just take a look at this plot and just walk out from the talk, right? So you're laughing. But this is the bottom line, N sub S versus R plot. When you throw in everything we've got so far, Planck temperature, low L polarization. Oh, I guess it's being updated from WMAP, I think, for this case. Lensing, and then BICEP CAC 14, direct BMO measurement. So far, BICEP CAC is the only experiment directly pushing down in this direction. And that phi square model is sitting out here already. This is 2 sigma, okay? So the cyan is 2 sigma, so it's out at almost 3 sigma. Okay, and also I was reminded by Starobinsky that we've already disfavored most of the convex models. Which some people like better than the plateau type models. So this is where we are when we throw in everything. So we just put out another paper yesterday, and that was about lensing. So like I said, so this part between L of 150 and 350, we've detected a lot of BMOs. That's definitely not dust, okay? And that looks like lensing. It follows the lensing power spectrum, and it has the right amplitude. And we know lensing should be there, so this should be lensing. But we went ahead and do the analysis. So there is a method that they can combine EMO polarization. This is the EMO polarization measured by BICEP CAC in green. And the B-mode, also measured by BICEP CAC in blue. Dash line compared to simulations, okay? So from the E modes and B modes, so those few points are the, you know, now known to be dust dominated. But we just cut it off at L of 150 and use this region of B mode and all of this E mode to do lensing reconstruction. Again, you're gonna hear about that next week, or you heard about it a long time ago. You can reconstruct the intervening dark matter potential field using E mode and B mode, or if you just throw in higher order statistics, all of the CMB measurements. And you can create a power spectrum for the convergence. It's very similar to weak lensing, is in fact a weak lensing. And you can calculate the power spectrum. This is a many sigma detection. And the interesting thing is, you can now derive the expected lensing amplitude solely from either the power spectrum, the B-mode power spectrum, which just tells you about the amplitude of B-mode, right? It has nothing to do with lensing or anything. You just guess it's lensing. So you can derive an amplitude from BK, BB, the allo power, and you get a value that's close to lambda CDM with uncertainty, within uncertainties. And you can go ahead and do the lensing reconstruction and calculate the lensing amplitude directly. And it also agrees with lambda CDM. So I think it's lensing, but it's not news to you, perhaps, that this is indeed lensing. But the interesting thing is, if you want to have a theory that can predict BMLD power in this L range, it's beginning to, the room is getting smaller because the stuff that we measured not only had a lensing power spectrum, but also had lensing statistics. So the good agreement between these two numbers tells you how much room you still have if you want to squeeze in an alternative model of BMOs, like string-generated Kaiser-Stepan effect type thing. So where are we going with this? So obviously, we want to add more and more receivers to get more and more sensitivity. I already showed you this. So this is that big jump we have to make from BICEP 2 to Keck. Yeah, if you don't put things with the appropriate scale, you don't know what we have to go through over the past few years. Theorists. So, and that incurred a lot of challenges, infrared loading. We have to develop all new infrared filters that are completely transparent in our band, but completely opaque, hopefully, in the infrared. How do you do that? We have to build bigger lenses, anti-reflection coat them, so that they'll still work at 4 Kelvin. And we have to build, completely redesign the focal plane so that the receivers now take modular focal length modules. Okay, there's some pictures taken over the past 2 years. I guess this is only a few months ago. And finally, we have a fully populated focal plane, all at 95 gigahertz. So if you go through the math, you realize in terms of power, at 95 gigahertz, it has 6 times less power sensitivity to dust, okay, if you normalize the CMB unit. Okay, so whatever BICEP 2 sees, if the dust component will automatically reduce by a factor of 6 at 95 gigahertz. And we have already confirmed the sensitivity of BICEP 3 is at roughly the Keck array level. Okay, so it's running at 7 to 9 microkelvin root second. So that means we are completely on track, okay? So this is our sensitivity at 95. We had no sensitivity before we added 95 gigahertz receiver. We were just integrating away sillily at 150 gigahertz. And then we'll say, oh, we have to add 95, and we started adding that 2 years ago. And now BICEP 3 is on track to follow the slope down to catch up with our sensitivity at 150 gigahertz, okay, with much less contamination with dust. And we also added 220 gigahertz, which is harder on the ground because the atmosphere is bright. At 220 gigahertz, a lot of water vapor. But we did that at the end of 2014, and you started to see the line coming down, okay? And we are here, midway through here. So this is helping this effort because there is enhanced sensitivity to dust sampling. And like I said, even at this point, our sensitivity to dust is already better than Planck's sensitivity to dust at 353 gigahertz. Okay. Just a brief summary here. and this is my finding chart. in a review article by Kamikowski and Kovets that came out a few months ago. Okay, so now, very roughly, R is limited to below 0.1, 0.07. We like that 30% less. But, you know. But as a theorist, you say it's less than 0.1. So it was published in a series of papers in PRL over the past 2 years. The latest limit is 0.07. This is 2 sigma, so 1 sigma is around 0.035 or 0.03. We got unlucky, and that got a little bit higher than 1 sigma. Okay, then 2 times 1 sigma. And all of that sensitivity is dominated, that uncertainty is dominated by, a lot of that is dominated by our mediocre sensitivity at 95, and also dust template, our sensitivity to dust template from Planck. Okay, so between 1 and 5 years, we're going to keep observing with BICEP 3 and Keck receiver at 220 gigahertz, and then we want to add more receivers the size of BICEP 3 in the next few years. So over the next 1 to 5 years, you know, R will be like 2 sigma, 0.01, you know, 0.02 will be easily achievable with the demonstrated technique. And then if it's not found, there are two big efforts. One is a satellite mission called Lightbird. It's a Japanese space agency mission with US contributions to detectors. And there's also a so-called ground-based CMB S4, stage CMB S4 effort led by the US Department of Energy Office of Science. It becomes a lab project, like a high energy experiment experimental project. So both missions are targeting 10 to the minus 3 level. Okay, 1 sigma r 10 to the minus 3. So one is a whole sky survey with 15 bands in space, but because it's a space mission and also a cheap space mission, it doesn't have a lot of resolution, angular resolution, so it can only see up to this L, okay? Meaning you can't use information from lensing to D-lens. Instead, you're trying to take advantage of this little bump at very low L, very large scale. And in combination, you get to, and also the fact that you can get access to many, many frequencies in space that you can't on the ground. So stage 4 CMB can't get access to that very low L thing, and it can't do a whole sky survey. So in terms of tensor, it'll focus on a smaller patch, go very deep, and with arc-minute resolution to do delensing. So if you can reconstruct the lens, you can predict what the beam mode you will see at a degree scale. Just simply by lens, the EMO polarization now measured to hundreds of sigma. So now this is mapped to extremely well sensitivity. You just take your lens, you lens that E mode, and it becomes a template for B mode that it can, in principle, subtract from the directly measured B mode. This is called the delensing technique. So these two complementary approaches, in principle, should both reach 1 sigma r of 10 to the minus 3 by mid-2025, about 10 years from now. So let's look at this fun finding chart, right? So there is inflation also affects the scalar perturbation and the spectral index for that perturbation. So under simple single-field slow-roll inflationary models, a constraint on NS will lead to a constraint on R for a given model. So, and these are all the very interesting, very well-motivated models. And this current constraint on NS translates into 3 sigma bounds for each of the models on R. Okay? So for example, there's a phi square. Phi square, our 2 sigma is 0.07, so this is really getting ruled out at this point. So this is 2 sigma, okay? Getting disfavored, heavily disfavored. So the next ones to go, well, I don't imply that they are not, you know, great, but if they are not the reality, the next ones to go are these ones, okay? So these will be heavily tested very soon. Okay, and then there's a class of model that predicts a few times. There's a central value, best fit, or lower limit, upper limit. So if we can get to that range with these guys, then you might be able to detect this even if you do a little better than this target, or if if this value is a little higher. But if you want a 5-sigma detection of this particular Starobinsky type model, it may be hard, even with these guys. But you can pretty much rule out the rest, even before this experiment turns on. Okay. Yeah, so this is a 15 bands in space planned by Lightbird with a 1-sigma R of 10 to the minus 3, including all systematics and foreground uncertainties. So 2025. Okay. So CMB S4 involves bigger telescopes. They'll map that lensing tail really well. 500,000 detectors on the ground. Again, mid-2020s. So in addition to R, it'll measure the number of species of relativistic particles, like neutrino-like particles, and absolute mass, or sum of the total mass of neutrinos, to 16 milliEV, 0.016, roughly. Okay, I'll just put up my conclusion here, and I'll take questions. Thank you.